some great person, apparently.
That's incredible. Dr. Rodriguez made us do poetry while we were there, which was really awesome. It was. And all of us got really into it. And I'm using it now. I'm gonna break down. someone else go first.
He's so hard to encourage.
I'm really tired too.
Grumina.
El bosque está vivando. The forest is alive. El bosque está respirando. The forest is alive. Los monos hallan las azules. Los hojas bailan y pelan. El bosque es de fiesta. The forest is alive. Los pájaros cantan Cristo fue. Las serpientes responden no con un hiss. El bosque está hablando. The forest is alive. Los insectos hay más que estrellas, y lo que no podemos ver aún, podemos conocer. El bosque siempre está creciendo. The forest is alive. El bosque está vivo. The forest is alive.
Taking the bus to the water, he was thanking us that we were there, you know, being present, because he said other than that he would be working the pineapple field. So that was something that was said with me, because it put things in perspective for me. I'm just gonna say my poem that we wrote when we came back from Costa Rica. Okay, so I took a 10-day journey to a place where every single star greeted me, not one hid it from my sight. The sky, it left me mesmerized by the hue of blue reflected. I found peace and beauty in it. I was taken back by the moon, because it was the exact moon I saw back home, shining a little brighter, a little clearer, shining glory through the peaks of the open canopy forest. My ears became familiar with the language of the birds as their calling to one another became my good morning song. The rain, as it dripped down from the cloudy sky, did not startle me, because it touched my skin. It was neither cold nor warm, it only existed. It surprised me how it could pour rain, yet bitter cold be absent from it. The river, sheltered by luscious greenery of forest, undisturbed from emerald to olive green, the trees told the story of design, leaving the original blueprint of architecture, nature authentic in its ability and presence, asking for nothing but to be valued. Nature rubbed off on me. The more I grew closer to nature, the less I felt constrained by standards and expectations. I felt like myself, evoked from my memory are those who made this journey an adventure from various walks of life, remembering to take your time and do it right. The laughter I remember will always cause me to laugh as I reflect on our experiences, those with passion for birds, some a passion for fish, and others a passion for wrestling iguanas, as well as sharing too much information when the struggle was very real. Dancing with the Ticos, a little suave mente salsa, and enjoying their culture, full of contentment and kindness, living the simple life, the pure life. The adventure was wild.
I don't have my poem with me, and I'm wishing I did. I didn't reading them, and I don't have mine memorized at all. So I just want to say thank you to like everyone that made this trip possible. Thank you to Dawn for dealing with like, well, how many of us were there?
Too many.
Excuse me. Just because like, if you've ever questioned what you want to do when you get out of college, if you ever question if you're going on the right path or anything like that, this really like adds clarity to everything. And for me personally, it solidified that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing, and like just brought me back to the passion that got me here to begin with. And also like It's amazing to see like a different world, to see the people go fishing for fun, not sit on their phone scrolling through Instagram, you know, like, and I think I made friends that are going to last a lifetime, so it's definitely worth it, and thank you to everyone in the university for making it possible.
The beautiful biodiversity that we all witnessed there, I think was, what was even more phenomenal was the hospitality that was shown to us. I couldn't even, it's hard to put into words the welcomeness that they showed to us. So if you haven't really, if you haven't experienced that yet, I definitely encourage you guys to experience it. So I highly recommend you guys go to Costa Rica.
So we woke up really early sometimes, and then, like really early, like the sun wasn't even out yet, like it's okay. But we first started doing that and we work, and it was just so beautiful out there, especially when we went to La Selva. Like I was just naturally waking up at like 5 in the morning and went for a walk into the rainforest, and it's just like, it's nothing you can imagine. It's like just being out there and you just hear like frogs and all these different birds like chirping, and you're just like walking through there just like by myself. It's like, I've never been more at peace like in that forest, and it was just phenomenal. Like even like taking it up like how I did with the drone and like seeing everything out for like you got to see a little bit of it there, but it's just amazing out there. And like Lee said, like the people are just so nice, and it was great. I wish we had more time, honestly. Yeah, and definitely, I would definitely recommend this experience to everybody. Especially like the way we did it too, like with our peers and like we're learning. It was just such a different experience. It's like the we worked, but it was like, not, I didn't even feel like we were really working, you know? We wake up early and stuff like that, but it was just like, it was great. It was great, guys. Do it.
Do it. So when we were there, we were working. You saw an interview with one of the UNA students, Gabriella. And Gabriella and the other UNA students and the professors, they were educating us about not just their culture and their hospitality, but some of the things they were doing. And at their school, they banned single-use plastics. And yeah, we thought that was a really cool thing. And we noticed as we went around, there's like no trash. Well, not none, but a lot less than even we see here and we see in other places around our own country. So it was really awesome seeing that and seeing that sort of social activism going on. And they've passed a law in their nation to ban it come January. Yeah, so Chelsea wants to share about this too, I think. But it was something we brought back here with us.
I think just the momentum that we got over there, we carried on here back to the States. Don't leave me, Daniel. I don't even know what I'm going to say right now. The momentum we brought, you know, we got there, we brought back over here, and we decided to, we as in, you know, our class, Green Generation, Surfrider Foundation, just SRI, you know, SRI team and all of them, to start this campaign back here called Make CI Green Again. And our eventual goal is to pretty much ban single-use plastics on CI campus. I'm sure most of you have heard about this little campaign going on, and we are still in the early stages of it, but I just wanted to thank, you know, CI, our professors, and pretty much everyone involved in this Costa Rica trip to allow us the opportunity to even come about this idea that we would not have even thought of having before this trip. So thank you to everyone, and we'll keep you updated with progress with this campaign. So if you could just please support us, and definitely go back to Costa Rica if you get the chance to.
And don't bring plastic. <It's not allowed. laughs>
But yes, thank you. Anything else?
This trip, like New Orleans, always is an emotional thing for me because it changes worldviews. You see yourself and your country from a different perspective, right? When you enter into a different culture, and there's a bit of humility that goes with that, and then that's a good thing. It's a good thing. It's a good thing from the perspective of maybe we don't always have the right approach or the right answers, and the interaction we have with the Costa Rican students there kind of spawned this single-use plastic approach, and I think those kinds of things are really, really rich, much better than anything you'd ever get in a classroom. very transformative kind of thing. So I applaud all of you guys for doing this. I think it's a commitment on your part, right? You're working early in the morning. It is challenging at times, but it says a lot about you too that you're willing to step out of your traditional role and do this in a place, a different place. And keep that enthusiasm, keep that inquisitiveness about the world around you. It'll serve you well.
It was a similar experience, though, with the culture shock, basically. I mean, it's not a different country, but it could as well have been. The community was similar. It's Costa Rica, very welcoming. And everyone we met, like, didn't want to leave. They loved it there.
Yes.
So even with the flooding and all the damage, they still want to stay there, and they still want to make it work. So we want to help them do that. And I learned a lot about that. I learned about the mapping. I learned about so much stuff. And it was a great trip. And I thank you very much for the opportunity.
So I've actually been in New Orleans maybe about 7 or 8 years ago, and my experience was completely different. I was just there hanging out in the French Quarter, having beers, and having a good time. And this was like a really rewarding trip to actually get back to the community and help everybody out, like plant gardens and like work on these nature conservancies. It's definitely not something that like I had a perspective of New Orleans going in, and it was really rewarding to actually like help these people and like give a shit about them. So yeah. I really appreciate the chance to go. Thanks, Sean.
So, like Chase said, we really didn't get in touch with our emotional side, but I think that we really had this amazing opportunity to meet these people that, like he said, really lost everything. The first night that we went there, we were at this jazz bar called Bullets, and we were really wanting to talk to these group of old people that were sitting at this table. Like, you could definitely tell that they were a little bit older and a little bit more experienced. We wanted to hear their like what had gone on in their lives. So we went up to Sean, we're like, Sean, how do we like talk to these people? Like, you're so good at just going up to people. By the end, we definitely weren't asking that question, but he told us like, I'll just ask him, like, you come here often? Obviously, it's not a high school dance, so we didn't. But we asking these people to tell us their stories, and they told us about how they lost everything when that levee broke at the lower ninth ward, and how they almost lost their daughter, and all of the stuff that had really broken them, and they were sharing it freely with this random kid that walked up to them. Which was really interesting to see just how open these people could be. And on a different note, we had these amazing opportunities to listen to this music that is so different from anything I ever would have. Listening to songs like Aiko Aiko, which became our morning jam. At one point you saw, Sean said that the mic was broke because the music was so loud, but we listened to sea shanties, which is like pirate music, so.
Yes!
Thank you, Captain Sean, for bringing us on this amazing trip and forcing us to look outside of ourselves in a really wonderful way.
Wrap up, and again, I want to say that there's posts outside you guys can check out, and there might be some food left with the birds that haven't been eaten. So thanks for everybody. Thanks for both classes for coming. If you guys have not come on one of these trips, I would strongly encourage you to consider it. Hopefully one of ours, but if not one of ours, one of our colleagues' trips, right? So we travel for a couple different reasons. We travel to learn about other places and people and all that wonderful stuff, and that's a key reason. In our case, we travel to help people too, right? So one of our goals is to give to our fellow people and our fellow planet, or other parts of our planet. But the other reason, as you guys heard, right, we travel to learn about ourselves. So sometimes it's really easy to get down in the dumps, or sometimes it's really easy to think, oh, woe is us, right? And traveling sort of puts us into an uncomfortable position. Sometimes it's your head on the airplane, sometimes it's the food you're eating, sometimes it's the way the sun comes up, but whatever it is, it sort of shakes you a bit, yeah? And it really is helpful for you to understand our place here. And some of you guys are getting ready to graduate and go on and do other cool things with your life. And it's easy to forget, or easy to not see how unique and how special an opportunity we have. So, again, you know, we don't have a lot of money here. We don't always have all these resources we'd like to have. But you really are the chosen. You're the blessed ones, right? I mean, you really, really are. Almost all of humanity doesn't have the luxury that you guys have had, that you guys have right now, to learn, to take an opportunity, as we're talking about, to see other things and show connections, right? And right now, in our country in particular, but also it seems around the world, there's a lot of people telling you that you should hate other people, right? That it's good to be different, and those people suck, and this is that, and all that kind of jazz. And that's ridiculous, right? So we just had the 50th anniversary of one of my favorite speeches from Dr. Martin Luther King on the mountaintop, and then he was, you know, disgustingly, crushingly killed the next day. But he wasn't going to give that speech. So sometimes when we look back and we see famous people and we see amazing historical events, we look back and we say, oh man, that was really, you know, that person's great and that person's always great. Dr. Martin Luther King was incredibly tired. He was getting worn down. He started his Poor People's Campaign. And a lot of his allies left him, right? And said, well, we don't want to be working on that issue, and we don't want to be talking about the war in Vietnam and that kind of stuff, right? So he was getting worn down. He was super tired. He had his PJs on, and he was in bed. And one of his colleagues came up and said, hey, these folks are waiting here at this church. And so we sent one of his friends, and he's like talking to him, but they want to see you. And he could have sat there and said, oh man, I'm so exhausted. But instead he rolled up and went, all right. And he took off his PJs, and he put on his pants, and he put on his suit, and he went down and he gave this amazing speech, which was the last speech of his life, right? And when we look around and see all this weird stuff, Dr. King said, the way to deal with hate is with love, right? So when you hear people saying we should go apart, you should be hugging people more, yeah? And so these trips are an opportunity to do that. And so we're a science major, right? So we don't typically talk about poems or love or stuff like that, but it's really, really important. And it actually is really important. And that's part of being a real good steward of the land. It's part of being an important citizen and a contributing citizen of this planet. So I'm super glad that you guys all had amazing experiences. But I think would like to leave you with the hope that you guys that went on this trip, you guys that didn't have the opportunity, you go on these trips and you keep doing these trips, right? And keep giving back. And that's the legacy of we, the instructors, is being able to help you guys see that. And we get to see the world through your guys' eyes, as Don said. And so thanks for everybody for coming. Thanks for staying awake late. Thanks for getting sick. Thanks for writing songs. Thanks for doing all the awesome stuff you guys do. And make sure that you thank the IRA and the administration, because this is not easy, right? Letting people go on a bungee line. Everything else we do, right? It's like there's always reasons not to. They let us do